Good morning all. A warm welcome to all of you on the occasion of ASSOCHAM's COVID-19 awareness series, third session in conversation with Dr. Randeep Guleria. My special welcome to Dr. Randeep Guleria and our office bearer for making it convenient to attend and participate in this initiative. ASSOCHAM, being a responsible apex body of the country, has come up with COVID-19 awareness web series to create awareness among the people about this deadly virus. Two seasons of this series have been successfully completed in the presence of leadership, leading diabetologist Dr. V. Mohan and cardiologist Dr. Naresh Trehan. While the coronavirus pandemic is a cause for consternation and concern for the entire world, a patient with the respiratory problems has to be even more careful as they have worse outcomes if they become sick with COVID. It is important to understand the transmission and the effect of the virus, which had made it a pandemic. Today, we have Dr. Randeep Guleria with us to enlighten us. He is a part of India's COVID-19 response effort. Dr. Randeep Guleria is an Indian pulmonologist and the current director of the AIIMS, New Delhi. He is credited with the establishment of India's first center for pulmonary medicines and sleep disorders at AIIMS. He is credited with the efforts in establishing a center for respiratory diseases and sleep medicine at AIIMS, which is reported to be a first in India. He was honored by the Government of India in 2015 with the Padma Shri, the fourth highest Indian civilian award. Dr. Randeep Guleria was a personal physician to Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji, former Prime Minister of India. I am keenly looking forward to this interaction and would request all audience to please send in their queries in the chat box for the speakers to respond. Further not taking much of your time, I would like to invite Mr. Jitendra Sodhi, Chairman, ASSOCHAM, Himachal Pradesh State Development Council, and Chairman and Managing Director, Ayush Group of Companies, India, for his opening address. Mr. Sodhi.
Thank you, Vipinji. At the outset, I would like to thank you all for joining us today for the insightful session of ASSOCHAM COVID-19 Awareness Series in conversation with Dr. Randeep Guleria Ji, Director, AIIMS, and world-renowned pulmonologist. Special thanks to Dr. Guleria Ji for his valuable time, and it's a privilege to have you on this ASSOCHAM web series. It is well known that people with comorbidities are more prone to COVID-19 infections and leads to high death rates. With your insights today, with your tips today, with the great knowledge you're going to share with us, I'm very sure that our people will be well, they will be getting to know more about it, and they'll be much helpful today. People has faced a big challenge, not only in the India, but the whole of the world is facing all this, and the whole world is working on it. But your services towards were remarkable. You've been world-renowned pulmonologist and have rendered beautiful services, as Vipanji has said. You have so much on your, in the colors you are having. And it's really a privilege to have you today. And I request all the people who has joined us today that please put your questions for Dr. And he'll be happy to answer your questions today. I won't take much time because people are here to listen, Dr. Randeep Guleria Ji, and I will not stand between all of them. At the end, I'll come back again with you people. And meanwhile, I'd like to tell you that we, ASSOCHAM, has conducted several series with diabetologists, with the renowned doctor, then Dr. Trehan, for the renowned heart specialist. And today we have Dr. Randeep Ji. So welcome all, and thank you very much, Dr. Randeep Ji, for coming again, coming here for us, sparing your time from your so busy schedule. Thank you, and we look forward to talking to you.
Now, we would like to invite Dr. Randeep Guleria to share his vast knowledge on the following: how COVID-19 has affected patients with the respiratory diseases, how to reduce the chance of getting infected from this deadly virus, or what to do in place in case one gets affected. What is the way forward as we have moved ahead with the fear of new waves? It is my pleasure to turn on to Dr. Guleria. Sir.
Thank you very much. At the onset, Shri Jitendra Sodhi Ji, Chairman, ASSOCHAM Himachal Pradesh State Development Council and Chairman and Managing Director, Ayush Group of Companies India. Shri Vipin Kharbanda, Vice President, Media Marketing, Divya Himachal. Ms. Kajal Gupta, other dignitaries of ASSOCHAM. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, let me really congratulate ASSOCHAM for this COVID awareness web series. And I think this is something very, very important that they're doing. And I think it is remarkable that they have taken this up upon themselves to really increase awareness among their members and in the general public as to how to really go about managing this pandemic. I shall be talking on COVID in general, but I'll focus on COVID-19 in patients with respiratory diseases or patients who have pulmonary diseases. What I will try and do in the next 25 minutes or so is to give you a broad overview, and then we can have an interactive session with question and answers. So we all know that COVID-19 is a viral respiratory infection, so it involves the lung and causes what we call severe acute respiratory syndrome. And that's why it has got the name of SARS-CoV-2, because of the fact that it is affecting the lungs. It causes it affects the lung, but the involvement in the lung may be very minor. And you may have people who are asymptomatic, some who have mild to severe disease, and there are people who have severe and life-threatening disease. So it's a disease which has a very wide spectrum as far as the clinical manifestation is concerned. Important to understand the pathogen. What is this coronavirus? Coronavirus is named so because it looks like a crown, from the Latin word corona. And it is a large family of viruses that cause illnesses which range from common cold to more severe illnesses. There are actually 7 coronaviruses which affect humans. 4 of them cause mild symptoms like common cold, cough, and fever. But there are 3 which we know cause very severe involvement and go down into the lungs, causing damage in the lung. And they are one which is known as SARS-CoV, which was severe acute respiratory syndrome, which we saw in 2002 and 2004. There's another one which is still there to some extent in the Middle East, known as MERS-CoV, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, again thought to have origin from possibly bats, but then camel is the source, and therefore from camels it has come to humans. And that's why it's seen predominantly in the Middle Eastern area in Saudi Arabia. And now we have SARS-CoV-2, which is a new strain which started from Wuhan in China in December of 2019. So the last 15-20 years, we've seen a lot of viruses affecting human and jumping species. As a matter of fact, in the late 90s and early 2000, we have what was known as bird flu, H5N1. After that, we had SARS. Then we had Ebola, we've had H1N1, which is known as swine flu, we've had Zika outbreaks, and we've had MERS, and now we have coronavirus. So why is this happening? And this is happening because the world is becoming smaller, we are traveling, and we can carry the infection quickly from one place to the other. There is a lot of deforestation, crowding is happening, there is a lot of movement from rural to urban area, and all of this is leading to the higher chance of viruses jumping species and mutating to cause infection among humans. I had written an article in 2018 regarding 100 years of the flu pandemic, and really said that we are still vulnerable and we are prone to future pandemics, and we need to prepare for new pandemics which may come in the near future. If you look at what the current data suggest, we have a huge number of cases right now. And if you look at the data, we almost 195 million cases, 4.1 million deaths, and almost 3.87 billion people have been vaccinated. This is remarkable that in such a small span of time, not only have we developed a vaccine, but have been been able to give it to about 3 to 4 billion people on our planet, which is a remarkable achievement as far as science is concerned. If you look at India has currently almost 31.4 million cases have been reported from India, which is the second highest documented. But actually, if you look at it, cases per million, our number of cases is much less. So the large number of cases reflects the large population size that we have. We are coming out of the second wave, although I don't think we're still out of it, because we still have about 30 to 40,000 cases being reported every day. We're seeing a huge surge in the number of cases in certain states like Kerala. and some states in the northeast, and therefore this is a time to be very, very wary, because things like this can lead to emergence and development of new waves. Our cases have also come down, and they are gradually now coming down, but active cases are down. But like I said, we still haven't reached a situation where we could say that we're out of the second wave, and we are still very much in the second wave, although we are at the declining part of the second wave. Going back to 1918 Spanish flu, because this is something that we can learn from, this pandemic also caused a huge number of deaths. And this came in waves. The first wave was smaller. The second wave was very large, because it was felt by people that at that point in time that they had the pandemic was over and appropriate behavior was no longer there. There was a lot of partying. This led to a huge second wave and a subsequent third wave. At that point in time, also, if you look at data from India, there were huge number of deaths reported in India. Remember, this is the time when it was a British India. And also, there were no antivirals, there were no vaccines. This is the pre-antibiotic era of 1918. But remember also that there was travel only by ships and or by the land route. Yet, despite the fact that travel was not as fast as it is today by air, still a huge number of people, almost 30 to 50 million people in the world got infection. In India, it was estimated that almost 7 to 10 million people died in this pandemic. And our population at that point in time was only 389 million. So we've had a huge pandemic about more than 100 years ago, and we're going through another one right now. This is the picture from the 1918 pandemic of a gymnasium. Could very well be a COVID care center today. We have patients who are there separated, and everyone is wearing masks. Mask at that time also became fashionable and was worn by many people. And public gathering and places were closed by leaders, and masks was mandatory even by police for policemen as part of the overall strategy to come out of that pandemic in 1918. So lots of learning from that pandemic, which happened more than 100 years ago. Coming to COVID-19, we know that it is transmitted mainly by droplet infection. That is particle size more than 5 microns, which stay in the air for some time and then quickly settle to surfaces. And therefore, it was felt the surfaces are also a source of infection. More recently, there is data suggesting that there is also what we call aerosol transmission. Now, what is the difference between droplet and aerosol transmission? Droplets are particles which are of larger size, more than 5 microns, and therefore they don't stay in the air for a long time because of their size. They quickly settle on surfaces, and the chances of getting infection is limited to a limited area. Aerosols are particles which are of much smaller size, less than 5 microns. And because of their small size, they can stay suspended in the air for a much longer period of time. So if you're in an indoor environment and one is COVID positive and one is coughing without wearing a mask, the virus will come into the environment and stay there and stay suspended for quite a long time. And you may even go out of the room. And if someone else comes into the room and he feels that I'm all alone and therefore I can't get the infection, he may still be predisposed to the infection, because the virus may still stay suspended in the air. And that is why we say that even if you're inside, you should consider wearing a mask, and there should be very good cross ventilation so that the air is quickly exchanged and fresh air comes into that indoor environment, into the room. You all know the common symptoms, which are predominantly respiratory, cough, shortness of breath, sore throat, and then you can have fever, chills, muscle pain, and loss of sense of smell. The gold standard for testing is the RT-PCR test or the rapid antigen test. The rapid antigen test, if it is positive, you are definitely having COVID-19. If it is negative, it does not rule out COVID infection, and therefore you must get your RT-PCR test done. Now, why are patients with respiratory diseases vulnerable, or are they vulnerable? Now, it's important to understand how this infection really spreads. The virus, which is shown here, actually attaches to the cell, and this occurs in the nose, throat, and in the lungs, to what we call ACE2 receptors, and by this virus actually enters the cell. Viruses are organisms which are between the living and the dead. The virus cannot survive on its own. It needs the host cell. It has to hack into the host cell's machinery and force the host cell to make copies of itself. And that is how the virus propagates. It cannot multiply on its own. It needs a host or needs a person cell to really multiply. And when this virus enters our cells that is in the nose and throat. It causes a direct cytotoxic effect. It causes dysregulation of what we call the renin-angiotensin system, and therefore it causes injury, and then subsequently leads to damage of our blood vessels. And that is why we see a lot of clotting and occurring as far as COVID is concerned. And it alters our immune system, which leads to what we call cytokine storm or cytokine release syndrome. So although the infection starts in the lung and causes a lot of damage to the lung, it also causes swelling in the vessels in the lung, which spreads to other parts of the body, and therefore it causes more of a systemic illness. Like I said, you can have asymptomatic, pre-symptomatic or mild illness, or you can have pneumonia, you can have what we call ARDS, and then you can have what extra pulmonary manifestation. Now, what is important to remember is that COVID-19 causes much higher mortality in the older age group. If you start looking at this chart, and this is from the early data from the infection, in people who are less than 50 years of age, the mortality was only 0.4%. But as you went up 60 to 69, the mortality was 3.6%. More than 70 years, mortality was 8%. And more than 80 years, mortality was almost 15%. And in this, if you added other comorbidities, including lung diseases, this went up significantly. That is why various diseases like obesity, hypertension, diabetes, lung diseases, kidney diseases are important, and we need to control them. And these people who have these diseases, especially the elderly individuals, are more prone to severe illness. If you look at the evidence, if you look at what we call COPD, or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which occurs in people who are smokers or who have exposure to indoor air pollution, there is a very strong evidence that you have a high chance of severe COVID-19. If you have other diseases in the lung, like interstitial lung disease, pulmonary hypertension, cystic fibrosis, again, there is some evidence that there's an increased risk of severe COVID-19. But in people who have asthma, especially if it is well controlled, the evidence is not that strong that you have a high chance of severe COVID-19, and this is something that we need to keep in mind. Now, this is a study which looked at a lot of patients who had chronic obstructive lung disease, chronic bronchitis, and looked at severe COVID disease, and this looked at 7 studies. And what they found was that COPD was associated with a significant, over a 5-fold increased risk of severe COVID-19 infection. And therefore, these people who have underlying COPD or chronic lung disease have a much higher chance of having more severe COVID-19 infection. The use of tobacco, which is the cause of COPD, along with indoor air pollution, can cause infection both by increasing the chance of you getting COVID and also causing more severe COVID. So how can you get COVID? One is, you see a lot of people use tobacco on their palms, they rub the tobacco on their palm and then take it into their mouth. So putting tobacco products on your lips means that your fingers come in close to your face, and this can lead to the virus spreading from your fingers to your nose and throat by this route. Secondly, tobacco is usually often a social activity, and this also can lead to spread of infection. I remember one patient whom I saw very many months ago. He was a lawyer, and he told me he was COVID positive, and he said, I got COVID from a friend of mine. I had not met him. He had come to the office. He was having fever, but he didn't really tell me. But I went out to share a cigarette with him, and we shared a cigarette. And after that, he got COVID infection. So it's very important to keep in mind that things like this can actually increase the risk of you getting infection. And then those who go out and have hookah, or the hookah bars that we often see, here also that is shared, the hookah is shared, and this can also lead to higher chance of getting the infection. Also, like I've said, tobacco leads in, especially when you smoke tobacco, it leads to damage and inflammation in the lungs, and this actually leads to a higher chance of getting more severe COVID infection. So I think it's very important for those who take tobacco either through the as inhaled through a cigarette, BD, or through even other use, or who chew tobacco, they must remember that they have a very high chance of not only getting COVID-19, but also of getting severe disease. What are the effects of COVID-19 on the lung? And I like to just say that it is a respiratory infection. Therefore, lungs are the major organ infected in COVID-19. And what it can cause is mild symptoms such as cough, breathing difficulty, fever. But there are also other things that it can cause. Once the lung gets extensively involved, it can lead to what we call respiratory failure. And that's why the oxygen saturation falls, because the lungs is not able to extract oxygen, which the body needs. And that is why the saturation starts falling and they go into what we call respiratory failure. If oxygen becomes low to the heart or to the other organ, the person goes into what we call multi-organ failure. And often it also leads to shock because the blood pressure tends to come down. Why does it affect the lung? Because like I showed you in the previous cartoon, that the human cells have what we call ACE2 receptor, and these are found in the upper respiratory tract and the lower respiratory tract. And the virus actually attaches to these ACE2 receptors, which are found in the respiratory tract. And once the virus starts multiplying in the cells, then the lungs get inflamed, a lot of other cells get accumulated there, and it leads to the lungs, that is the alveoli where gas exchange occurs, getting full of fluid. And because of that, the oxygen is not able to go from the air that we breathe in into the blood. At the same time, there is also evidence that there is what we call microthrombus, that is in the lung vessels, clotting occurs, which also blocks these vessels and doesn't allow the blood to go into the lungs, and thereby there is decrease in oxygenation. So in the short term, it leads to what we call just symptoms like cough, sore throat, and nasal symptom, and it's predominantly in the upper airways, the nose and the throat. But then it can go into the lungs, leading to a viral pneumonia. And if this pneumonia is very severe, it can lead to respiratory failure. This is a CT scan of a person, and what you're seeing here in the white area here is all the infection that is happening in the lungs. So the central part is the center of the chest, where you have the vessels and the heart. These two black areas that you're seeing are the bronchi, where the air goes into the lung. The black hair is actually the air. The white patches are all because of the infection because of the virus. So this is bilateral in both the lungs. You see these huge white patches causing infection in the lungs. Now, like I said, COVID-19 also affect other systems and body parts, the lung being the predominant organ. But now we've realized that it is causing involvement of other systems, the neurological systems, the renal system, the kidney, the liver, the GI tract. 20% of patients may present with diarrhea. It leads to heart involvement because of the inflammation of the blood vessels. And there can be endocrine and dermatological involvement. So although the focus is the lung, but it does become at times a multi-system disease. The long-term effects, which now people are getting more and more concerned about, is what has been caused as lung fibrosis. Although I think this is a misnomer, because many, very often what looks at fibrosis changes, and this is not a permanent change, but fibrosis means a permanent architectural distortion and irreversible damage to the lung. Now, this has been reported even in the past with SARS and MERS, especially in severe cases, but gradually tends to improve. There is one data from China which followed a patient almost from 15 years who had SARS-CoV infection in 2002 and showed that there was gradual improvement in the lung function, but in many, they continued to be damaged to the lung. Who are the patients who have more likely chances of getting long-term damage to the lung? Those who are elderly, those who have severe illness, stayed in the ICU for a long time, required mechanical ventilation, and those who are smokers, because smoking already affects your lungs, and even chronic alcoholism has been found to be a factor. So if you go to this syndrome of what happens once you recover from COVID, the so-called long COVID, majority of many patients who have recovered continue to complain of fatigue, breathing difficulty, because the lung again is affected, and then they have joint pains, chest pain, and cough. So one must remember that almost, data suggests that almost 30% of people, and some studies suggest that almost up to 80% of people who recover from COVID have symptoms even after they have recovered from COVID, and many of them have chest pain, breathing difficulty, and cough because of the involvement of the lung. But along with that, they also have other symptoms like stress, impaired memory, poor concentration. And therefore, it's important for us to understand that COVID-19 may impair quality of life for weeks to months, even after a person has recovered. And that is why there is now in many hospitals like ours, a post-COVID clinic to really help these patients and support them with treatment. So how do we treat these patients? In general, the treatment is symptomatic, but once you have breathing difficulty and fatigue, even once you recover from COVID, it's important to remember the three P's: planning, pacing, and prioritization. Plan gradually to get your work, come out of your work. Do important tasks when you expect to have the most energy. Some people say that they are feeling more energy during the morning, but as the day passes, they become very, very tired and start having breathing difficulty. Pace your work. Don't really think that you've come out of COVID and you can straight away start your gym and go back to work. Do it in paces and do take breaks in between. And prioritize so that you do things that are required first and then gradually build on your on that. Also have a very good sleep hygiene. It's important that you get good sleep. This helps in recovery. And therefore, going to bed and getting up at the same time, avoiding caffeine and alcohol, and having good sleep hygiene is very, very important. Then gradually you must start physiotherapy and rehabilitation, breathing exercise, yoga is something good. And we advise a lot of patients to do that. Also upper and lower limb exercise, but do it at your own pace. And gradually one should start coming back to a normal activity. But along with that, have a good healthy diet. And like I already said, if you are smoking, quit smoking. Then we must also treat psychological factors. This is something that we have a lot of people ignore, but I think this is very important as far as recovery is concerned. So anxiety, depression, concentration are important things. And sometimes people do need some medication for that, but meditation, exercise help as far as this is concerned. And those who have symptomatic, have some symptoms like cough and pain, the treatment for that can be given. However, there are some patients who will have changes in the lung, but in many of them, by the third month, we find that they tend to improve. Remember, I showed you these white patches, and this, if you look at this CT, you can see these white patches. But after about 3 months of discharge, they have gone and it has become much clearer. And therefore, many patients will gradually improve and these changes will improve. And that's why I said this is not totally irreversible. In many, it does reverse. Now, if you have lung disease, what precautions should you adopt? And I think these are five things that you must keep in mind. Get vaccinated, get tested and treated if symptoms occur. Don't delay that. Follow COVID appropriate behavior. If you have any emergency which is lung related because of your underlying lung disease, don't ignore it. Sometimes people are reluctant to come to the hospital because they feel wahan ja ke COVID ho jayega or I'll get some other disease. And always take your prescribed medication as directed. Don't get panicky that because of COVID, you should stop your medication. I'll briefly touch on all of these five important points. One is get vaccinated. Vaccination has been shown to be the most effective public health measures to end the pandemic. And now more than 3 billion people have been vaccinated worldwide. There is optimism that this may be the beginning of the end, but there are still some unanswered questions. Are vaccines safe and effective? And I would say that now with 3 billion people being vaccinated, we can safely say that they are effective and safe. Will they prevent disease transmission? To some extent they do, and there is now data emerging that that does happen. How long will the benefit last? This is a tough question. Only time will tell, but it does last for a significantly long period as more and more data emerges. And will they be effective against the new strains? These are important questions. First, vaccines are worked by causing an immune reaction in us so that antibodies are formed without exposing us to the disease. And this is the first time for one disease. There are more than 60 vaccine candidates in human trials and over 180 in preclinical trials. Never in the history of mankind has there been so many vaccines being developed for one disease itself. And I think this is the year of vaccinology, as I put it. But we must understand how do they work. Vaccines can work by preventing infection. You get vaccinated, you don't get COVID at all. Now, vaccines to some extent do that, but they are not 100% effective against that. But they're very effective in preventing illness. That is, you get COVID, the virus stays in your nose and throat, it multiplies, but the antibodies don't allow the virus to propagate further and you don't get severe disease. You are therefore protected, but you get the illness, you RT-PCR is positive, and to some extent you are also infectious and you can spread the disease to others. But the vaccine definitely prevents hospitalization, prevents intensive care units, and prevents death. And we have now more and more data emerging, not only from the West, but from our country also, that these vaccines are effective as far as this is concerned. Data from our own institute, where we looked at almost 20,000 healthcare workers, showed that those who had been vaccinated, even if they got COVID infection as part of after vaccination, they did not get severe illness. Vaccination also prevents death, and to some extent it does prevent transmission also. This is also shown very classically in what is happening in the UK. In the UK, there is another third wave which is going on, and now they are having almost 30 to 40,000 cases per day. But it is not reflected by increased hospitalization. The blue figure shows the number of cases. The black chart at the lower part shows the deaths. And as you can see, the deaths have not really gone up. The cases have gone up. Whereas if you looked at the previous wave, the cases and the deaths went hand in hand. What it means is that the vaccine is preventing people from getting severe disease, although people are getting mild disease and are also spreading the disease, but they are protected. And this is a very important message which we are seeing also in our country. Even if you look at Kerala, Kerala is having a large number of cases. But again, if you look at the data from Kerala, we are not seeing so many hospitalizations. We're not seeing so many deaths. So therefore, the vaccines are preventing people from getting severe disease and thereby making the virus cause a milder illness, which will be more acceptable to us in the long run. We have the Covishield vaccine, Covax, and Covaxin, which are introduced in January of this year, and now also Sputnik has been introduced. Covishield is what we call a viral vector vaccine, and so is Sputnik, and Covaxin is what we call an inactivated vaccine. Now, India was the vaccine capital of the world. We were producing almost 60% of vaccines before COVID, but now we have also become the research area for vaccine. We have various companies which have come forward and started doing research in vaccine. Covaxin was made by Bharat Biotech. ZyCoV-D, which is a DNA vaccine, first time in the world, has been made by Zydus Cadila. Sputnik is now going to be manufactured by Dr. Reddy's laboratory. Serum Institute of India is coming out with Novavax. Biologically, another Indian company is coming out with what we call a protein antigen vaccine, which is basically a protein antigen based vaccine. And then we have another mRNA vaccine, which is coming out by Genovia by the end of the year. The advantage of this vaccine is that unlike the other mRNA vaccine, this vaccine can be kept at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade. And Bharat Biotech is also coming out with a different platform where the virus can also be given as a nasal spray. So I think there's a very robust vaccine platform, and I think we will see second and third generation vaccines coming out in the coming months and years, which will give us better immunity and better protection against the new variants. So there are vaccines which have efficacy ranging from 94% to 66% as far as trials were concerned, but in clinical evidence, the vaccines all are working very well. Bharat Biotech vaccine also has a 78% efficacy against severe disease, 65% efficacy against the Delta variant, and like I said, it has a 93% efficacy against severe COVID-19 as far as hospitalization is concerned. So vaccines are making a big difference. And India has had a very good vaccine response. Now over 40 crore Indians have received the vaccine. And this is very, very heartening as far as India's response is concerned. So as of 28 July, 44.61 crore individuals had been vaccinated. The second important thing that I mentioned was get tested and treated if symptomatic. If you have any symptoms which suggest you could have COVID infection, get tested as early as possible, especially if you have lung disease. Remember two things. One is the earlier tested, the faster the treatment that can be started, and newer treatments are emerging. We have monoclonal antibodies, which can be given to people with comorbidities and with severe illness, and this can help, and they're available in our country. This is the same treatment which was given to Donald Trump. And these monoclonal antibodies are effective if they are to be given to that category of people who have a chance of getting severe illness. Also, drugs like remdesivir and steroids are available, but are used have to be used only if you need them, depending on your oxygen saturation and severity of illness. Third important thing is follow COVID appropriate behavior. Reopening and lockdown being lifted does not mean that the virus has disappeared. The virus is still there in the community. So stay at home and try and maintain physical distancing. Don't go out unless it is absolutely necessary. Wear a mask in public. If you're outside, please wear your mask properly and maintain hand hygiene and avoid touching your face in public places. So social distancing or physical distancing is more important. That is a better term. Wear your mask properly. It should be snug and should comfortably fit against the side of your face. It should cover both your nose and the mouth, and there should be no air coming in from the side of the mask. It should get filtered through the mask and then come in. Don't wear it around your neck or cover only your mouth and not your nose. Hand washing is also something important, especially whenever your hands look dirty, before, during, and after you prepare food. And this is something that we used to do in the past. In India, it was very natural that whenever people came home, the first thing they did was to take the shoes off and wash their hands. We need to really look at all of these habits and make sure that we are washing our hands regularly so that we don't allow the virus to spread from our hands to our face. Do these really work? And this is something, again, if you look at the 1918 pandemic, those cities in the US which had strict policies as far as these behavior was concerned, they had less mortality, and they also were able to open up more quickly. They were able to get back to their manufacturing and re-employment much more faster. So therefore, social distancing and masks still are the cornerstone of any pandemic response, and we need to keep that in mind. The fourth thing is lung health emergencies are still emergencies. So even if you have, even if there is outbreak of COVID going on in your area, if you have a respiratory problem, you suddenly have acute worsening of your asthma, worsening of your COPD, don't avoid seeking healthcare, because there are patients who have died because of the fear of going to the hospital. So if you have a life-threatening respiratory problem, please seek medical advice and consult your doctor and visit the emergency. So when going to the healthcare facility of any kind, make sure that you maintain physical distancing, you have clean your hands, and you wear your mask. Fifth thing is to continue your medication as prescribed. So even during the COVID pandemic, people with chronic diseases, whether it be respiratory diseases, whether it be heart diseases, whether it be diabetes, must continue their medication. And you must continue your oral and inhalers if they have been prescribed to you, because we don't want that your respiratory condition should worsen. Because with that state, if you get COVID-19, it can lead to more severe illness. So even if you're using a nebulizer, you can take your medication at home. It is safe and you should continue to do so. If you are COVID positive and you're taking a nebulizer, then you must consult your doctor as to how to take it, because nebulization is also can lead to more aerosol production, and you have to be careful that others don't get infected because of the nebulization that you're taking. Should patients using inhaled glucocorticoids and having asthma or COPD be advised to stop these medications to prevent COVID? Absolutely not. Steroids should be continued, and you must continue your treatment. As a matter of fact, they will help to minimize the risk of getting severe attack of asthma and COPD. And there is no good evidence that inhaled glucocorticoids increase your susceptibility to COVID-19. As a matter of fact, they may be useful, and therefore you must continue to have these medications. Therefore, to conclude, I'd like to just say that the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic, is not over, nor is it the last pandemic. It is time to invest in pandemic preventive measures. Social distancing and masks are still the most effective public health measures to prevent the spread of the infection. Patients with chronic lung disease are more at risk for severe COVID infection. Please be extra careful and continue your medication. And if you have any problem, you must consult your doctor. And therefore, use telemedicine or teleconsultation if you have any doubt. More importantly, you are at a higher risk. Please get vaccinated. And we must learn from lessons of the past and prepare for future outbreaks. Thank you very much. And therefore, I'd like to conclude by saying that the future depends on what you do today. Thank you very much. I think you're muted.
विपिन जी आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही.
सर आपने बताया 1918 वर्सेस 2021 कोविड, देन टोबैको यूजर्स एंड स्मोकर्स देयर हाई चांस ऑफ सिवियरिटी, देन अस्थमा यूजर्स नो हाई चांस. वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट यू हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट वैक्सीनेशन, एप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर, गेट टेस्टेड एंड ट्रीटेड इफ सिम्टम्स अकर, फॉलो कोविड एंड एप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर्स अगेन, लंग हेल्थ एमरजेंसीज, देन कंटिन्यू योर मेडिकेशंस एज प्रिस्क्राइब, wear mask, social distancing and wash your hand. These are the three tools with us for COVID-19, inse bachne ke liye. So now sir, let's open the house for the questions from our attendees, if any. There are most of the questions we have already answered, sir, which we have which we have received. Even then there are a few questions which we have. So the question has come up, like, is it safe to continue using my nebulizer at home for inhaled medications?
Yes, like I said, nebulization is safe and you should use it. What is the disadvantage of the nebulizer? If you are COVID positive, then you should be careful, because when you use a nebulizer leads to a lot of aerosol generation, and therefore the room can contain the infection and you may give the infection to others. So you must do it in place where the chance of the infection happening to others is less and there is good cross ventilation. But if you are COVID negative, then you should continue to use the nebulizer. If you want, you can switch over to what we call the other inhaler, the metered-dose inhaler or the dry powder inhaler. That is also equally effective. Otherwise, nebulization can continue.
Right, sir. Then we have a question, sir. Like, people with chronic lung disease have a higher risk for complications from COVID-19. वैसे आपने इसके बारे में बताया. Then even then, please, in very few, one or two lines.
Yes, definitely. Like I've said, because when you have lung disease, your lungs are already compromised. Your lungs already aren't working at a less optimum condition. On top of that, if you get COVID infection, then it becomes more severe and your saturation falls quickly and you can get more severe COVID. That is why those who have an underlying lung disease are more prone to severe disease, because even a mild infection can become severe for them because the lung does not have that reserve that other people have. That is why, like I said, the five tips that I gave in the end in terms of being careful, taking your medication, getting vaccinated and avoid following COVID appropriate behavior is more very important for those who have underlying chronic lung disease.
Right. Then we have another question, sir. Should I use a pulse oximeter to monitor my oxygen levels?
So pulse oximeter is not usually advised for people who are otherwise healthy and are asymptomatic. We were using pulse oximeter in the past for people who had chronic respiratory failure. Some patients with COPD or ILD, their saturation was less than 90 and they were using what we call long-term oxygen therapy. But for healthy people, there is no need to use a pulse oximeter. We are now advising it only for those who have COVID and are advised home isolation so that we can monitor them for any worsening. But in routine practice, pulse oximeter is not advised for normal people, even if they have asthma or some degree of chronic bronchitis.
Sir, abhi question hai teesri lehar ke bare mein. Teesri lehar ke bare mein bataein, agar teesri lehar aati hai, तो वो कितनी खतरनाक या प्रभावशाली होगी?
तो ये इम्पोर्टेंट क्वेश्चन है कि अगर तीसरी लहर कैसी होगी. ये डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चन है क्योंकि हम बता नहीं सकते कैसी होगी तीसरी लहर, लेकिन ये बात सही है कि वी विल हैव इंक्रीज इन नंबर ऑफ केसेस एंड देयरफॉर वी शुड बी प्रिपेयर्ड. दो तीन चीजें हमारे फेवर में है. पहली चीज तो ये है कि ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोग वैक्सीनेट हो रहे हैं, और जैसे मैंने अभी डेटा दिखाया आपको यूके का और कुछ हद तक केरल में, और हमारे और डेटा आ रहा है कि जो अगर हम ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों को वैक्सीनेट कर देंगे तो अगर आगे वाली लहर भी आएगी तो उसमें इतनी सीरियस डिजीज नहीं होंगी कि हॉस्पिटल्स भर जाएंगे या ऑक्सीजन की कमी हो जाएगी. दूसरी चीज ये है कि जो सीरो सर्वे का डेटा आया है उसने भी ये हमने देखा है कि ऑलमोस्ट 50 to 60% ऑफ जो पॉपुलेशन है उनमें एंटीबॉडीज बन गई है क्योंकि उनको या तो वैक्सीन लगी है या उनको नेचुरल इन्फेक्शन हो गई है, तो काफी हद तक हमारी पॉपुलेशन में कुछ हद तक इम्यूनिटी आ गई है। और अगर हम ये दोनों चीजें देखें तो मेरा ये मानना है कि अगली लहर जो है उसमें केसेस इतने ज्यादा नहीं आएंगे और ना इतना ज्यादा हमें जो सिवियर इलनेस होगी जो हमने सेकेंड वेव में देखा उस टाइप की सिचुएशन होने के चांसेस कम है।
सर तीसरी लहर के बारे में भी चर्चा चल रही है, तो उसमें जब बात आती है बच्चों के बारे में भी, बच्चों को वैक्सीनेशंस नहीं हुए हैं, तो क्या कोरोना की तीसरी लहर में बच्चों पर क्या प्रभाव पड़ेगा?
तो लोगों का ये कहना था कि क्योंकि बच्चों को वैक्सीनेशन नहीं हुई है और वो एक ससेप्टेबल पॉपुलेशन है और जैसे वायरस की अगली लहर आएगी तो औरों में तो वैक्सीन लग जाएगी, बच्चों में वैक्सीन जो है लगी नहीं और उसमें उनमें ज़्यादा सीरियस इलनेस हो सकती है। लेकिन ये भी बात सही नहीं है क्योंकि इसमें दो तीन चीज़ें हैं। पहली चीज़ तो ये है कि अगर हम पिछली लहर देखें, फर्स्ट वेव देखें, सेकेंड वेव देखें और वेव्स देखें, ग्लोबल ट्रेंड्स देखें, बच्चों में ज़्यादातर इन्फेक्शन माइल्ड होती है और बच्चों में इतनी सीवियर इन्फेक्शन नहीं देखी गई है, इसलिए अनलाइकली है कि आगे जाके भी बच्चों में सीरियस इन्फेक्शन होगी। दूसरा, अगर हम जो सीरो सर्वे की मैं बात कर रहा था, अगर हम उसका डेटा देखें, उन्होंने इस दफा सीरो सर्वे बच्चों में भी किया और ये देखा कि 55-60% बच्चों में इन्फेक्शन हो चुका है और उनमें एंटीबॉडीज बन चुकी हैं, तो बच्चों में माइल्ड इन्फेक्शन हुआ है और वो ठीक हो गए हैं, इसलिए ये चांसेस हैं कि उनमें अब सीरियस इन्फेक्शन शायद नहीं होगा। ये डेटा हमने अपने स्टडी में भी देखा क्योंकि हम वैक्सीन ट्रायल कर रहे हैं बच्चों में, तो जब हमने वैक्सीन ट्रायल बच्चों में शुरू की तो जो भी बच्चे आते थे वैक्सीन के लिए हम उनकी पहले एंटीबॉडीज देखते थे कि कहीं उनको इन्फेक्शन तो नहीं हुआ, क्योंकि उनको फिर वैक्सीन देने का फायदा नहीं है। हमने ये पाया कि ऑलमोस्ट 50% से ज़्यादा बच्चे जो आए हम वॉलंटियर करके वैक्सीन लगाने के लिए, उनको ऑलरेडी एंटीबॉडीज बन चुकी थी, उनको ऑलरेडी कोविड हो चुका था, इसलिए मेरा ये मानना है कि बच्चे कुछ हद तक प्रोटेक्टेड हैं। अगर बाद में उनको होगा इन्फेक्शन तो माइल्ड होगा और अगली लहर में ऐसा नहीं है कि बच्चों को सीवियर इलनेस हो।
अभी सर हम लास्ट के से तीन क्वेश्चंस देंगे सर, कीपिंग इन माइंड द टाइम फैक्टर। सो नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज रिगार्डिंग अगेन दिस थर्ड वेव, तीसरी लहर की आशंका होने पर हॉस्पिटल्स में क्या तैयारी होनी चाहिए?
तो तीसरी लहर की आशंका में दो टाइप की हम तैयारी कर रहे हैं। एक, क्योंकि लोगों में डर है कि बच्चों में ज्यादा होगा, तो पीडियाट्रिक पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से भी हम देख रहे हैं कि अगर बाय चांस ऐसा कुछ होता है तो हमें तैयारी पूरी होनी चाहिए, तो उस पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से जो हमें कंज्यूमेबल चाहिए, वेंटिलेटर चाहिए, उसकी तैयारी है। हमने जो सीखा है पहली वेव और दूसरी वेव में, उसको उससे आगे जाके तैयारी हो रही है कि हम हर हॉस्पिटल में ऑक्सीजन प्रोडक्शन प्लांट्स लग गए हैं, जो हम कहते हैं PSA प्लांट्स, स्टोरेज प्लांट ऑक्सीजन के, जो हम कहते हैं लिक्विड ऑक्सीजन स्टोरेज के लिए फैसिलिटीज क्रिएट की गई हैं, और ICU बनाने के लिए प्लानिंग हुई है, और हमने एम्स में कई मॉड्यूल्स बनाए हैं जिससे हम डॉक्टर्स की ट्रेनिंग कर रहे हैं, इंडियन मेडिकल एसोसिएशन को इन्वॉल्व करके रूरल इंडिया को भी कवर कर रहे हैं कि देश के पूरे हिस्से में, चाहे वो अर्बन इंडिया हो या रूरल इंडिया हो, वहाँ डॉक्टर्स की ट्रेनिंग हो प्रॉपरली कि कोविड के केसेस अगर आए तो उनको कैसे मैनेज करना है। तो ये पूरी ट्रेनिंग जो है, ट्रेनिंग पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से, इक्विपमेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से और मेडिसिन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से पूरी तैयारी की गई है।
अच्छा सर, अभी देखा जा रहा है कि स्कूल के बच्चे और ऑफिस कल्चर, मोस्ट ऑफ द ऑफिसेज आर क्लोज, वर्क फ्रॉम होम चल रहा है और स्कूल्स एंड कॉलेजेस बंद पड़े हैं, और अभी उस पर तैयारी चल रही है कि उस पर किस तरीके से स्कूल्स खोले जाएं, तो सर इसमें आप क्या, आपके क्या व्यू पॉइंट्स हैं ऑन द स्कूल रीओपनिंग्स फॉर द चिल्ड्रन, वेलफेयर ऑफ द चिल्ड्रन?
मेरा ये व्यू पॉइंट है कि हमें स्कूल, अगर कुछ जो एरियाज जहाँ पे पॉजिटिविटी रेट कम है और हम देख रहे हैं कि केसेस कम है, तो विद क्लोज सर्वेलेंस एंड विद स्ट्रैटेजी जिससे हम इन्फेक्शन को फैलने ना दें और उसको ऑब्जर्व कर पाए, हमें स्कूल खोलने चाहिए। क्योंकि अगर हम ये देखें कि स्कूल्स आर नॉट ओनली पार्ट ऑफ एजुकेशन, दे आर पार्ट ऑफ कैरेक्टर बिल्डिंग, दे आर पार्ट ऑफ सोशल इंटरेक्शन, दे आर पार्ट ऑफ चिल्ड्रंस ओवरऑल डेवलपमेंट। ये डेवलपमेंट घर में बैठे बैठे एक टीवी के सामने, एक कंप्यूटर के सामने नहीं हो सकता। दूसरा, कई ऐसे बच्चे हैं जो जिनके इंटरनेट अवेलेबिलिटी नहीं है या कंप्यूटर नहीं है या स्मार्टफोन नहीं है, दे आर बीइंग डिप्राइव्ड ऑफ एजुकेशन और इसलिए वो दे आर लिटरली ड्रॉपिंग आउट ऑफ स्कूल। अगर हमें इस जनरेशन, जो हमारे फ्यूचर जनरेशन है, उनको प्रॉपरली एजुकेट करना है, उनकी प्रॉपर कैरेक्टर बिल्डिंग करनी है, उनको और बेटर ह्यूमन बींग्स बनाना है, तो हमें ग्रेजुअली स्कूल खोलने पड़ेंगे और स्ट्रैटेजी बनानी पड़ेगी। हो सकता है कि हम हाइब्रिड मॉडल देखें कि आधा स्कूल एक दिन चले और दूसरे लोग ऑनलाइन आए और फिर आधा स्कूल अगले दिन चले, स्क्रीनिंग करें बच्चों की और उस एरिया में पॉजिटिविटी रेट देखें, अगर पॉजिटिविटी रेट बढ़ता है तो स्कूल बंद कर दें, अगर कम है तो फिर स्कूल चलने दें, जिससे एजुकेशन भी हो, बच्चों की डेवलपमेंट भी हो, लेकिन हम कोविड पे पूरी नजर भी रखें।
सर एक लास्ट क्वेश्चन लेंगे सर, हमारे व्यूअर कह रहे हैं कि कोविड कैसे और कब खत्म होगा?
ये तो बड़ा मुश्किल सवाल है, पर मैं ये कहना चाहूंगा कि कोविड के जो मैं मानता हूँ कि दो फेजेस होंगे। एक फेज होगा जब कोविड बहुत कम हो जाएगा एंड वी विल बी कमिंग बैक टू अ न्यू नॉर्मल, कि कोविड के केसेस तो आ रहे हैं पर इतने ज्यादा नहीं है, हॉस्पिटल पे स्ट्रेन नहीं है एंड वी आर लिविंग विद इट। वो सिचुएशन जो है होपफुली बाय अर्ली नेक्स्ट ईयर आ जानी चाहिए कि वी शुड बी एबल टू से कि कोविड हमारे साथ है लेकिन इतना कोई अब घबराने की बात नहीं है एंड वी आर कमिंग बैक टू अ नॉर्मल, बट कोविड अप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर शुड स्टे। मे बी इन अ ईयर और टू एक ऐसी सिचुएशन आएगी हम कहेंगे कि हमारा वायरस पे बहुत अच्छा कंट्रोल हो गया है एंड नाउ इट इज लाइक एनी अदर वायरल इलनेस एंड देन वी कैन कम बैक टू अ प्री कोविड एरा। उसमें हो सकता है एक डेढ़ साल और लगे।
एक बड़ा इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन एक और आया हुआ है, हाउ टू प्रोटेक्ट चाइल्ड बिलो 5?
तो चिल्ड्रन बिलो 5 जो है उसमें दो वेज हैं छोटे बच्चों की अगर हम बात करें। पहली चीज तो मैं ये कहूंगा कि जो ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग मदर्स हैं उनको वैक्सीनेशन लगा लेना चाहिए। अगर ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग मदर्स वैक्सीनेशन लगाती हैं तो उनके बॉडी में एंटीबॉडीज बनती हैं और ब्रेस्ट मिल्क के थ्रू वो बच्चे को भी चले जाती हैं और इससे बच्चे को भी कुछ हद तक प्रोटेक्शन मिल जाती है। तो इसलिए हमारी गाइडलाइंस भी यही कहती हैं और ये डेटा भी है कि प्रेग्नेंट वुमेन अगर ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग वुमेन अगर वैक्सीनेशन लगाएं तो इससे बच्चे को भी फायदा मिल सकता है। दूसरी चीज ये है कि वैक्सीनेशन के ट्रायल हो रहे हैं और जो कोवैक्सीन है भारत बायोटेक की वैक्सीन उसमें 2 साल से ऊपर वालों के में भी वैक्सीन की ट्रायल की गई है, तो होपफुली अगले 2-3 महीने में ये अप्रूवल आ जाएगा और छोटे उम्र के बच्चों में भी वैक्सीन लगना शुरू हो जाएगी।
सर बहुत सारी रिक्वेस्ट आ रही है आपको सुनने के लिए, दे आर एंजॉइंग योर सेशन, बट टाइम नहीं है हमारे पास, हम एक लास्ट क्वेश्चन सिर्फ लेंगे एंड देन वी विल सम अप। व्हाट आर द चांसेस ऑफ गेटिंग इन्फेक्शन इफ वन हैज गॉट इन्फेक्टेड और टेकन वैक्सीन?
सो इसका इशू है कि व्हाट इज द चांस ऑफ व्हाट वी कॉल ब्रेक थ्रू इन्फेक्शन, कि आपको वैक्सीन लग गई तो भी आपकी वैक्सीन का असर नहीं और ब्रेक थ्रू इन्फेक्शन होगी। अब मैं फिर से वही कहूंगा कि हमें समझना चाहिए इन्फेक्शन और डिजीज के बीच में क्या अंतर है। अगर आपको पहले इन्फेक्शन हो गया है या अगर आपको वैक्सीन लग गई है तो आपके शरीर में एंटीबॉडीज बन जाएंगी जिससे आपको डिजीज नहीं होगा, आपको हॉस्पिटल में जाने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगी, कोविड के कारण डेथ नहीं होगी और सिवियर कोविड नहीं होगा। लेकिन माइल्ड इन्फेक्शन फिर भी हो सकता है, आपको थोड़ा एक्सपोजर हो सकता है। वैक्सीन अभी इतना प्रोटेक्टिव नहीं है कि आपको हम ये कहें कि कोविड से आपको एक पूरा शील्ड मिल गया और आप उसको वायरस आपके अंदर घुस ही नहीं सकता। तो माइल्ड इन्फेक्शन हो सकता है, आपका आरटीपीसीआर भी पॉजिटिव हो सकता है, लेकिन एंटीबॉडीज जो बनी है, जो वैक्सीन लगी है, जो पहले इन्फेक्शन हुई है, वो सीरियस डिजीज नहीं होने देंगी और इससे आपको प्रोटेक्शन मिलेगी। लेकिन इसीलिए हम बार बार यही कहते हैं कि चाहे आपको वैक्सीन लग गई हो चाहे पहले कोविड हो चुका हो, कोविड अप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर बहुत जरूरी है, क्योंकि अगर वायरस म्यूटेट भी करता है तो अगर हम मास्क लगा के रखेंगे, 2 गज की दूरी रखेंगे, हाथ धोएंगे, तो चाहे कोई भी वेरिएंट हो वो अंदर नहीं आ पाएगा, हम उससे प्रोटेक्टेड रहेंगे। तो चाहे वैक्सीन की एफिकेसी कम हो जाए, कोविड अप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर की एफिकेसी कम नहीं होगी। इसीलिए ये बहुत जरूरी है समझना कि अगर हमें नए वेरियंट से भी बचना है तो कोविड अप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर, बाहर जाएं तो मास्क लगा के रखें, 2 गज की दूरी रखें, हाथ धोएं, उससे हम बच सकते हैं और ये बहुत जरूरी है जब तक ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों को वैक्सीन नहीं लगता।
थैंक यू सर। सो नाउ आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट मिस्टर सोडी फॉर अ थैंक नोट एंड आफ्टर दैट वी विल सम अप द सेशन। मिस्टर सोडी।
थैंक यू वेरी मच विपिन जी, डॉक्टर साहब का बड़ा ही इंसाइटफुल सेशन रहा, बहुत ही डीप नॉलेज के साथ इन्होंने हमारी सब जनता को बहुत अच्छे ढंग से बताया कि पल्मोनरी डिजीज से कैसे इट कैन इंक्रीज एंड व्हाट पीपल शुड डू, व्हाट दे शुड डू फॉर पोस्ट कोविड विद द 3 P's, बिहेवियर एंड ऑल दैट। ये जो आपका डॉक्टर साहब सेशन रहा, इससे मुझे बहुत उम्मीद है कि लोग हमारे बहुत benefited होंगे and जब मैं क्वेश्चनों की सीरीज देख रहा हूँ विपन जी के पास आई थिंक बहुत सारी होंगी, इन्होंने काफी सारे स्क्रूटनाइज कर दिए होंगे क्योंकि आपने बहुत कुछ ही कवर कर दिया था. बट वैक्सीनेशन की इम्पॉर्टेंट बताई आप लोगों को, वैक्सीनेशन से कैसे लोग ठीक रह सकते हैं. लोगों के बीच में बहुत सारे क्वेश्चन थे कि कोवैक्सीन लें या कोविशील्ड लें या पुतिन लें या फाइजर की लें. सो आई थिंक वेरी वेरी वेल आंसर्ड ऑल द क्वेश्चन एंड हम लोग, मेरे लिए भी बहुत कुछ नया था, आपके बहुत इंसाइटफुल था. मैं समझता हूँ कि जो ये सेशन है ऐसा आपसे एक साथ और कर लें ताकि हमारी जनता को और बहुत सारा क्लैरिटीज हो जाए. एक क्वेश्चन मेरा भी आपसे रहेगा, आपने जो फीडिंग मदर है उनके लिए तो बोला है, जो प्रेग्नेंट विमन है उनके बारे में आपसे जानना चाहूंगा क्योंकि वो वरिड होंगी, तो अगर उनमें से कुछ सुन रहे होंगे तो दे मेक एट आंसर कि क्या वो वैक्सीन लें, और वैक्सीन लेते हैं तो क्या उनके बच्चों को कुछ, जैसे आप बता रहे हैं कि फीडिंग में तो थोड़ी सी इम्यूनिटी क्रिएट हो जाएगी, तो इज इट पॉसिबल सर?
यस डेफिनेटली. हम मैं ये भी ये कहना चाहूंगा कि जो प्रेग्नेंट वुमेन है, गर्भवती महिलाएं हैं, उनको भी वैक्सीन लगाना चाहिए. अब हमारे गाइडलाइंस में भी अप्रूव हो गया है और इसमें डेटा बहुत यूएसए से आया है कि जो प्रेग्नेंट वुमेन है अगर उनको कोविड हो जाए तो ये चांस होता है कि उनको थोड़ा सिवियर डिजीज हो सकती है. इसलिए उनकी प्रोटेक्शन के लिए भी, फीटस की प्रोटेक्शन के लिए भी, और जैसे आपने कहा कि कुछ हद तक जो न्यू बॉर्न बेबी है उसकी प्रोटेक्शन के लिए भी उनको वैक्सीन लगा लेनी चाहिए.
सो नाइस ऑफ यू डॉक्टर गुरेरिया जी, आपने हमारे लिए इतना समय निकाला, हमारी जनता के लिए इतना समय निकाला. आई नो यू आर हैंडफुल ऑलवेज इन योर एम्स एंड एम्स आपको देखती रहती है, सारी दुनिया आपको देखती रहती है. टू लुक फॉरवर्ड टू मीट यू एंड हैव योर गाइडेंस ऑलवेज एंड वी आर लकी टू हैव यू टुडे ऑन आवर सेशन. थैंक यू वेरी मच. आई लाइक टू थैंक्स ऑल द मीडिया पार्टनर्स, स्पेशली दिव्या हिमाचल एंड विपिन खरबंदा जी फॉर देयर काइंड सपोर्ट टू एसोचैम. And I'll go back to Vipan ji. Thank you very much, Dr. Randeep Guleria ji, once again from Asuchan.
Thank you, Sodhi sir. Thank you very much for your words. Dr. Guleria, thank you very much, sir. And we are very much sure that this was a very knowledgeable and insightful session for everyone. And thank you all our partners for supporting us. And now the next session of the series we have planned is on nephrology patients, and details will be shared very soon. And look forward to all to meet you all again in the next session. And sir, dobara se aapka bahut bahut shukriya sir. Session bahut acha laga sir. Sabne enjoy kiya aur it was a very knowledgeable session. Aur ye jo questions aaye sir, chote chote questions, aam janta ko abhi bhi covid ke bare mein, covid behavior ke bare mein nahi malum hai, jo bhi aapne itni clarity de di hai. और आपकी क्लैरिटी का मतलब है इट मींस समथिंग. सो आई थिंक एवरीवन विल फॉलो द कोविड बिहेवियर एंड विल बी आउट ऑफ दिस फेज फ्रॉम कोविड 19 वेरी सून. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. थैंक यू वेरी मच. थैंक्स टू ऑल.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. थैंक यू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट. थैंक यू
सर.